Welcome to this very special Good Friday video service. It's brief, concise, but hopefully very beneficial to all of our church family and all those who watch with us around the world. My prayer is that it will bring focus and meaning and additional purpose to what these days are all about, because today we come to a moment in which we recognize and celebrate what it is that God has done for us that we could never do for ourselves. And I want you to think about for a moment as we stand at the point of Good Friday in anticipation of Resurrection Sunday. It's amazing to realize what Jesus did for us was change our lives forever. He gave us hope. He gave us meaning. He gave us purpose and he gave us direction. And he gave us an example to follow that was perfect because he was perfect. And you see, for each one of us, we have to be willing to look inside of our own hearts. And on this Good Friday, it's a great time to look in and see what you see and make sure that your heart is completely connected to God's purpose. And it's interesting to me that what you discover is that Jesus takes the disciples and goes to the garden. He goes to the garden with a purpose to beseech the Father, to pray, and to literally encounter God in a profound and powerful way. So look at it, if you would, in Luke chapter 22, beginning in verse 39. Notice what Scripture says. If you have your Bible, you would want to open this passage because I want you just to make note of a couple things that are really important, because this Good Friday moment is literally just to capture your attention to all that we'll look at by the time we arrive at Easter Sunday. But it's so important for us to take a few moments and be reflective, because you have to ask yourself the question, when it comes to Jesus in the garden, what was he doing? How was he going to accomplish the Father's will? And you'll notice he addresses that very distinctively. Verse 39, and he came out and proceeded as was his custom to the Mount of Olives, and the disciples followed him. And when he arrived at the place, he said to them, pray that you may not enter into temptation. Pray. All right. And what he's making very clear here is it's so easy for us to stumble and to experience something that is a temptation that would take us away from God's purpose. Look on. He said, and he withdrew from them about a stone's throw, and he knelt down and began to pray. Can you imagine how intimate and powerful this experience was, even for the disciples who are looking and watching and probably wondering as well, all that's about to transpire, about to happen. He's saying to the Father, Father, if you are willing, verse 42, if you're willing, remove this cup from me, yet not my will, but yours be done. Now an angel from heaven appeared to him, strengthening him. Now I want you to imagine for a moment that at the most crucial moment that Jesus was facing throughout his earthly ministry was to coming to the cross. And as he comes to the cross, as he comes to betrayal, as he comes to the bearing the sin of all the world, including mine and yours, it's interesting that heaven dispatches an angel to minister to him, to encourage him. Look on, verse 44. And being in agony, he was praying very fervently, and his sweat became like drops of blood falling down upon the ground. And when he rose from prayer, he came to the disciples and found them sleeping from sorrow. And he said to them, why are you sleeping? Get up and pray that you may not enter into temptation. It's interesting because what you realize is that Jesus had a very clear laser focus, and that was what could cost the disciples everything was to fall into temptation, to yield in a temptation. And so here you find this story unfolding, and it's interesting because really what the garden does is it gives you a perspective about prayer. It gives you a perspective about life. In fact, it brings you to an awareness of what it is that God wants you to know about your own journey of faith. And when I read this, I see that it's obvious that Jesus is taking them to a familiar place, but for a unique moment, because there's no moment like this in history. And what I want you to see today is this: what the cross does for us is it opens the door for us to have unique moments in which we encounter him and we experience him. And the story of Jesus comes alive inside of us because we understand what Christ has done for us, the sacrifice that he's made. And today I want to challenge you to think about, as you look at this, how important it is that you absolutely understand the level of sacrifice that is made for you and me. Because when you look at it, you realize that here he is, he's praying, and he's interjecting into his heart and life everything that he is about to face. And he makes it in his prayer. It's interesting, by the way. His prayer is not simplified. It's not some simple issue. It's intensified. Because there's nothing simple about asking to remove this cup from me. I mean, let me tell you, the intensity of this prayer time is evidenced by the fact that Luke records that as he prayed his sweat was his blood. Can you imagine? In other words, it was so intense that it was absolutely overwhelming, and his body responded to it. Imagine for a moment if you and I, on this Good Friday, could elevate our intensity to the place where we feel inspired by God to accomplish a purpose, that we feel God's presence at work in our lives on a moment-by-moment basis. Could it be that you and I, as we read this story, realize something, that for the disciples, the end part of this particular passage, they are asleep. They are asleep. And the Bible says they are asleep because of sorrow, which tells you there's no doubt they are now comprehending what's going about to transpire. And their comprehension overwhelms them in such a way that they find themselves closing their eyes to what they know they're getting ready to witness. You see, today, I want to encourage you. It's not time for us to fall asleep. It's a time for us to open our eyes. It's a time for us to open our eyes and realize that what Christ has done for us, we can never do for ourselves. It's a time to open our eyes and say to the Lord, "Lord, I want to seek you out. I want to experience you. I want to encounter you as the one who speaks to my heart and guides my steps." This morning, much earlier this morning, I had the privilege of sharing with a large group of children in a village in Pakistan, and the precious children being taught about Jesus and what he can do and how he can work. And so after I spoke with them about Easter and the significance of that, right here from our church building, thank God for technology, right here from our church building, I was communicating with them. And so then finally, near the end, I said, "I'd like to know if any of you have any questions." Three children had the same question. Why did Jesus have to be crucified? Why? Why did he have to go to the cross? And you see, here's what they were trying to grasp. That level of sacrifice was impossible for them to understand. And yet, if they ever come to the point where they understand it, then they trust in the one who did it for them, and that is Jesus. As I think back about those moments, and I think about all the beautiful children who are part of our church family, and all of our students, and all of our members, we all anchor ourselves with an intensity at the point of prayer, but with an inspiration at the point of the cross. You see, we pray seeking his face, and we're inspired when we look at the cross. And as we look at the cross, we understand what Christ has done for us. And today I stand in front of a piece of beautiful stained glass that was given to our church by one of our fabulous members, and it's the Apostle John. And whenever I get near this piece of stained glass, I'm always reminded of different verses in the Gospel of John, and especially when you look at John 10:10, because the Lord, it makes it clear, the scripture says it, that he came to give us life and give it to us abundantly. You see, think about that. The abundant life that God has for us is the opposite of what the thief tries to do. The thief tries to come, steal, kill, and destroy. But what Jesus does, he changes our lives forever. And today on this Good Friday, I want to encourage you to pursue the abundant life that he has for you. Recognize and acknowledge what the cross has done for you. You couldn't do for yourself. Recognize and acknowledge that you see this model of prayer, that you let prayer become a real clear focal point of your life as well. And today, as we anticipate Easter Sunday, it's so amazing that we get the chance to be able to gather together with a very distinctive awareness that he who began the good work in us will complete it, that Jesus is at work in each one of our lives. And may this short video be a reminder to you that on Good Friday 2021, Jesus is at work in our hearts and lives, in the hearts and lives of people everywhere, from little children in a village in Pakistan to One Heart Church in Norcross, Georgia. Jesus is at work. His prayer was answered. The Father's will was accomplished. And as a result of that, he died on a cross on this day. But remember this, 3 days later, he arose. He came out of that grave. And this Sunday, we'll understand what happened when Jesus encounters those, the very ones who'd been in the garden praying are now gathered together, locked in a room. And Jesus appears in their midst and says, quite simply, peace, be still. And my encouragement to you today is this, peace be still in your heart. Get ready for Easter. Remember this, that the grave is empty. The cross accomplished its purpose. Jesus died so we could have life. And that's what allows us to have an amazing opportunity to keep him first in our life. I thank God for each one of you. Let's pray together and let's ask the Lord to speak to your heart. Father, thank you for every person watching this Good Friday message. What an amazing story to challenge us at the point of the intensity of our prayers, but also to open our hearts up to the inspiration of what the cross really means for each one of us. Lord, thank you that the cross is more than just something we wear around our neck. The cross is a symbol of the sacrifice that God has made for us. So Lord, I pray your blessing on all of our church family, all those who are watching here and around the world. I pray a special blessing on every person who has been through difficulty during this year and with COVID and everything else. I pray, Lord, you would encourage their heart. And Lord, it is Easter weekend. We celebrate Jesus who is risen and with you forever. Lord, thank you for amazing provisions that are made for us by Jesus. We give our hearts to you. We ask you, Lord, to bless us. Keep us focused on you throughout this weekend. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, God bless you. I'll see you on Sunday, either online or in person, 10 a.m. this Sunday morning.